biomedical research, mining engineering, even philosophy. He spends a lot of his time in and out of the broadcast booth writing about science as it relates to everyday life. He has proudly won an Ig Nobel Prize for using physics to work out the best way to dunk a biscuit, and being voted by the Times newspaper as an enemy of the people. He's been coming to the symposium since 2002 and is now a member of the advisory board, and hopes to be able to use his knowledge of science to better some of the world's most serious problems. Dr. Lynn Fisher. Oh, sir.
Thank you. I'm well aware of the effects of cyber at lunchtime. So if you drop off, just could you please not snore? Or if you do snore, make it halfway through, because that can get a laugh and get me off the hook. Okay, with global warming and the global food landscape, I really only have one message, so I'm keeping it simple, but I'm also going to try to leave plenty of time for discussion later. And the message is this: as we've seen from many of the other talks, it's in our interests as foodies to promote diversity in agriculture, to promote diversity in our food system. What I want to show you here is in the world's interests too, and especially it is in the interests of ameliorating the worst effects of global warming to maintain as diverse a food supply as we possibly can. The talk is in a series of steps. The last one will actually be you talking to me. But the first, I'll just talk about how climate change, very briefly. I'm not going to make this a great diatribe. Either you believe in climate change and you accept the evidence, or you're an idiot. So that'll be the first very brief step. The second is to explain just why preserving diversity is so important. The third, I want to point out some of the major problems in preserving diversity, and I'll do that just by telling the stories of two countries, Tanzania, which is next door to the country that Jane Levy was talking about earlier, and Bali, where I was recently and got to talking about the rice crops. And this is where you come in. I'm then going to ask you, how can we overcome these problems? Because it's a bit of a pain, to say the very least. Just to start, here we are with, I was going to show a video, but I thought this was going to soak up time. But here, from the World Resources Institute, is a reasonable analysis, reasonably based, and most of what I will be saying, I'll be backing up with fact. This won't be wild assertions. Anything I say will be factual and backed up by the literature. But this is the calculation, of the best calculation, I think, of how crop yields are going to change between now and 2050, based on what's happening already and what we expect to happen with the climate. And as you'll see, here on the red, percentage change, and you'll see that, I'm not going to risk using this thing as a pointer, I'm just going to point, but you'll see that in sub-Saharan Africa, and in South America, even in Australia, we're heading towards much lower crop yields. And you might think, well, okay, because we're okay, look up north, where we got plus, we got bigger, and these are yields for the world's major crops. And right up in the northern hemisphere, we've got green, we have much better yields for many of the major crops. But the point to understand is that we actually get most of our food from these areas which are going to be worst affected. So that's going to affect us as well as affecting the people who actually live there. Now this is just a point, this is actually off to one side, but it's something I'm going to come back to later. In every major famine, there has still been enough food to feed all the people. But as B. Wilson mentioned earlier, and as the philosopher Amartya Sen has also spelled out, the fact is that the poor simply can't afford it. So they're growing food, they're selling it, but they can't afford to buy it for themselves. And I'll come back to that with respect to Tanzania, because it's a pretty bad situation, really. Incidentally, if you want to have, I wouldn't say a bit of fun, but follow up a bit more about the effects of various climate scenarios on future food supplies, the very best source is the UK Met Office. And the UK Met Office has, and don't bother about all the detail, has an interactive thing. You push the button, this is the one I was going to run. It just showed you the gradual changes in colour in the various countries. And you can run it for yourself, you can run it under various assumptions, you can read about the assumptions, plug them in for yourself. So what can we do? Well, James Rebank's, I thought it was a wonderful talk, and he argued that the old ways are the key to the future. One reason why the old ways are the key to the future, because they help to preserve biodiversity. And there's a fairly recent report from the FAO, the Food and Agricultural Organization of the United Nations, arguing that biodiversity increases the resilience of our agro systems. And you can see that intuitively. I'll come back to that again in a minute. And so it's an excellent way to aim for risk reduction and hopefully to allow us to adapt a bit to climate change. And there's evidence. People have looked at regions where extreme climate events have occurred, and they've found that the regions which have the farming practices that best preserve biodiversity are also those regions which recover most quickly, which don't get so much damage. So there is actual evidence that from things that have already happened, the biodiversity is a very strong. Now, this is not an example of biodiversity. This is, in fact, an example of an Australian scientist and his friend. His friend is a thylacine, which is an Australian native wolf that went extinct in the 1930s. Bob May is the president of the Royal Society, was the president of the Royal Society. He was the government's chief scientific advisor here. He was also my bridge partner when we won the Australian University Bridge Championship. The only thing I ever hear from him these days is when he emails me that he's got a brilliancy prize in the House of Lords Bridge Competition. Bob put a spanner in the works. He was a physicist, still is, I suppose. I don't think he knows much about zoology, really. But nevertheless, as a physicist at Sydney University, he came up with such profound mathematical insights into ecology that he was offered the chair of zoology at Princeton University on the spot. So he went straight from physics to zoology with no intermediate step. And one of the things that he came up with is the thing called May's paradox. Now, I said earlier, it seems intuitively obvious that if you have more diversity, then you're going to have a more stable system and ability to recover quickly. What Bob showed was that just the opposite is true. When you look at the mathematics, the more diverse a complex interconnected system is, and interconnectedness is what we're really talking about, the more diverse it is, the more it is likely to change under small perturbations. So just the opposite of what you'd think. And it's only, and this is why you have to think really carefully about biodiversity and not just start waving hands around. I think I'm one of the 2% of scientists who probably does actually understand it. And the secret was that what Bob's mathematics applied to was a system remaining constant as it was, holding its constancy, holding its state. Under those circumstances, the more diverse the system, the more susceptible it is. But if you are talking about the resilience of a system, whether it's a farming system or some other ecosystem, if you're talking about the resilience, the ability to adapt, the ability to recover, then just the opposite is true. And we've worked out all the maths now, and May's paradox has actually, thank goodness, gone away, because it scared the life out of the ecologists when it came out. And what is true is that the more diverse a system, the better chance it has of adapting and recovering from damage, from perturbation. So with that in mind, I'll just go back a sec here, keep Bob's lovely face there for a minute. and understanding the mathematics as we do now, and it's only quite recently that we do, but the mathematics, the practical experimental results that confirm it, only now, the World Economic Forum, and I've had my run-ins with the World Economic Forum, I don't think that my contribution had anything to do with what they've now done, but they've produced a really significant report on what we need to do in order to maintain our agricultural systems against the impact of climate change. And you can read all about this in the paper. All you really need to do is look down here. They said what you need is low connectivity. So small farms not necessarily interacting with each other too much. So they don't all become like a large Monsanto-driven group where one thing that happens, say one bug that develops that will attack a particular crop and wipe the lot out. You want the diversity, you want low, relatively low connectivity, and then you end up with this phrase that I love, as local as the new global. Protecting yourself against the effects of climate change means going local. But there are problems. And let me just tell you the stories of two different countries. One of the problems is the World Bank. In Tanzania, some of you may well know this story, but in Tanzania and in a lot of the poorer countries that now owe money to the World Bank, those countries have been directed to change their agriculture to growing crops to feed the West. To feed the people, as I said earlier, to feed the people who can afford it. That's us. And we're losing out because the diversity is gone. The locals in Tanzania especially are losing out. Monsanto, the farmers have to buy Monsanto patented seeds. It is illegal for farmers to exchange seeds between each other of their traditional crops. Illegal to the extent that a farmer can be jailed for a number of years just for doing what they've always done, which is to swap seeds to maintain diversity. Now that's a huge problem in my view, and it's happening more in just Tanzania, happens to be the one that I know about, but it's an enormous problem. Now let's go in the opposite direction. Let's go to the island of Bali, where I was last year, for the literary festival, but I spent quite a lot of time talking for the food people around Bali, because I didn't know about it. Some of you will know that the Balinese rice was exclusively turned over to golden rice from Ingenta. That's what they grew. And the farmers actually put pressure on the government, because what they were finding was with this almost monoculture of crops, it was getting very susceptible to pests, it wasn't giving them enough, and the government have backed the farmers' drive to go back to diversity, to go back to a variety of rice types within their rice paddies. That's happened, and they're doing extremely well indeed. I don't know how many of you were in the rice art talk about patterning in Japanese rice fields. That's deliberate patterning. People are growing different colours of rice to make it all look pretty. But have a look at this. These are Balinese rice terraces, which there's been a mathematical analysis of them published just in the last few months. And I promise you, you will love the mathematics. Some people here will know about fractal patterns, self-similar patterns. Or if you take a small area and blow it up, it just looks like the big area. These rice fields, these rice paddies, when you analyse them in that way, they form fractal patterns. But there's more to it than that, because you can now start talking about it in terms of sustainability. These fractal patterns, what they mean is that there has been a spontaneous pattern formation, not developed by an artist, but spontaneously, all these rice farmers, each pursuing their own aim, have come together and produced an almost ideal mixed farming community. Now that is just the opposite of what game theory, now the tragedy of the commons you've heard about, I won't go into game theory anymore. The tragedy of the commons is quite simply that if you have a group of people cooperating, and one of them starts to think, well, you know, if I cheat on this, like if I put an extra cow on the common or something, grow a few bit extra rice, then I can do better than the others. And the logic is absolutely impeccable. Until you find that everyone in the group is using the same logic. And when they all use the same logic and they all cheat, they end up doing worse than they would have if they'd maintained their cooperation in the first place. Now that tragedy of the commons is the thing that bedevils us. It really is a big problem. There's a lot of work being put into how can we get around this. These farmers have got round it. And it's a perfect example of how they don't have to not compete with each other, but by each trying to do the best for themselves, and in this case under the benevolent guidance of a religious spirit, I have to say, they get maximum sustainability, maximum yield. Just as simple as that. So we've got that, we've got the small farms, sustainable practices, by accident as much as anything, but mainly diversity. And the real key to the May paradox that I mentioned earlier is that when you look at a mixed community, and don't look at the individual species, you know, so much corn, so many trees, so many cows, etc. But if you look at the energy flows, and obviously I can't go into detail here, but I will amplify this in the written paper. If you go into the energy flows between everything, and I'm talking about, like was talked about in the main theatre before lunch, the bacteria in the soil, the nematodes, the trees, the grass, the animals, the insects. When you have all of this, and you have the energy flows working, then you have, through biodiversity, you have stability against attack, against climate change, whatever you like to say. You've got so biodiversity giving stability. So that's what we need to be promoting, really, for our own sakes, for the sake of the planet. This is what's actually happening, though. I'll leave you to read this. It's in black. My question to you is quite simple. What can we do in our small ways or maybe in a big way to promote biodiversity versus allowing this sort of thing to happen, which is they're going to lose out. That's the tragedy of the commons in action. They'll control the world's food supply, they'll go for maximum yields, maximum profits in the short term. In doing so, what they're effectively doing is cheating against what the agricultural, the ecological system needs. They're actually cheating, and the cheating is going to backfire. But they're going to make short-term profits. How can we get around it? I think you go right back to the very first talk in common.
30 seconds.
No, I haven't. It's 25 past.
Well, if you want to
But Colin Tudge, I didn't agree with much that he said, especially when I was told that all scientists are lackeys of big business. But one thing that he did say, which I think was quite important, was that this is going on. How can we stop it? It's driven by an economic theory, which actually is letting the planet down. What do we do? 30 seconds, done. Thank you.
Questions?
I thought this was fabulous and very interesting. I just have a question about the last slide, because you're mentioning six companies, and they would become three, but US, China, and Germany are already represented. The only one that drops out is Switzerland.
With agenda.
Because this buyer's already German, Monsanto, Dow, and DuPont are all U.S.
I guess it's only, it needn't have dropped out, but it's the these are the big mergers, one of which has happened and the other one of which is about to happen.
Yeah.
The other two of which are about to happen. So I just focused on those. That was what the report that I took it from said. Okay, so I'm quoting.
Okay.
This is just an observation.
You want to say it loudly, so it's
yeah. So Paul Reynolds is my name. I do work in sort of ethics and corruption. And if you look at the map, which is of the world, which is produced by Transparency International, which is a corruption index, it looks remarkably like your map of the world and the climate change one. So it looks like the countries which are highest in corruption are the ones which are going to have the highest impacts on your second map. And it might be an interesting research project for someone to put those two things together.
I think it already has been.
Okay.
We'll talk about it in detail. But in the World Economic Forum report, they factored in things like money draining away due to corruption,
yep.
money draining away from infrastructure. That I know in at least some of it, that was actually factored in, the money draining away from infrastructure especially.
Okay.
So yeah, but yes, it's a nice idea.
And it's, it lines up with that idea of the global north and the global south,
yeah.
and how those two systems or the haves and have nots and how those factor as well.
Well, that's absolutely true. Although you are still looking, especially sub-Saharan Africa, I was writing about this in the Encyclopedia of Food Issues, Ken Albala's thing, about 5 years ago, less than that, and already the situation is worse than I predicted when I wrote. Can't quite hear the last bit, sorry.
I invited a couple of friends to come with me, put it out on social media, so they don't want to go to that. And the resounding response was kind of minimal, like none. And one of my friends said, actually, it's a PR exercise with an agenda by these people, the Queen's agenda, about their GMO and seeds. So I went along going that line. And as much as there were a few people in the audience, scientists and various people who were clearly into the GMO idea, there was an enormous number of us who were thinking, we're not going to get away with this, we're not going to sit down and say, have this whole front line, the kind of what a company does. And their perspective was saying things like, if we have mushrooms at the supermarket or cauliflower, how frustrating is it when you have the mushrooms at home and they go off after a few days? And wouldn't it be nice if our mushrooms have stayed fresher for longer, like cauliflowers, not going around the top and right and not pick up the cauliflowers. And that was their reasoning for developing and really designing the seed, developing a new product like that. And I sat there going, no, it's not bloody, worry about it.
I think we've got to be very careful, very emotional debate about GMOs and so on. We've got to be careful to distinguish that from the economic drive, which is not to do with whether GMOs are dangerous or not. And I happen to agree with the guy who asked a question after Colin Tudge. I don't know who that was. Was it you?
No,
I
was just going to make a point, not you say that.
Yeah.
Just kind of going from your argument there, at the beginning you said you have to either accept climate science or you're an idiot. Just putting forward the argument that was previously there, and instead of saying GMO, looking at using genetic technologies such as CRISPR, such as actually seed marker tracking, those sorts of things, to look at what's happening in natural breeds of seeds or in terms of normal seeds, you can use these technologies, but not, and it's being used by Syngenta by Monsanto, but without GM. And so these are peer-reviewed as safe methods which are being used by these companies, not for GM, but for normal seeds. And so you've got to understand that there's another market as well that these guys are going into. They've abandoned GMO. That's an argument from 10 years ago, I'd say. So
yeah.
It's not just about GMO now, it's about seed technology and how you can breed the best for a number of methodologies.
It is, but also, I mean, okay, take the case of Tanzania. To me, it is basically unethical to require a country to grow food that it can't afford itself.
I agree, but the Tanzanian diet and the actual what you're looking at there is a change of what their base crops are, and they have 85% subsistence farming, and the farmers grow a different sort of crop for what they're eating in the household as opposed to what is based for export. And they're two very different markets there. And yes, I agree what they're doing for export is, and that's a very bad thing. But at the same point, you have a local amount of seeds that are being used on the farm.
You do, but that's also being undermined by passing a law that they can't swap seeds, that they can't promote biodiversity.
But they're not eating the maize, they're eating cassava, they're eating yam, they're eating sorghum.
Oh, yes,
a very different diet to what's being exported.
Yeah, but they can't exchange seeds for those either. And so I'm afraid.
One of the issues it raises, I think, is this idea of, you know, we can grow this, but how do we get it from here to there? And I think, I'm sure Tom will touch upon this a little bit, this idea of so many farmers that I meet say, I can grow this, but I can't afford to process it. USDA makes me do this, or I can grow this, but I don't know how to get it to the door of a restaurant. So that, I mean, there's that issue of this movement in getting these ideas from one place to another, and where does science fall on, on that?
I'm not pretending that this talk was not fairly simplistic.
Yeah.
It's a matter of getting a basic point over. These are complex issues, but I think there's one simple, central point. Somehow, just from the point of view of climate change, let alone from the point of view of variety in our diets, we need to find a way to preserve and promote biodiversity worldwide.
Yes.
And we haven't done it. We haven't had an answer here either. I'm really surprised.
So one little answer is to change the way we eat.
Yes.
Yeah. So we have to change the way we eat to drive biodiversity into food markets.
Yes.
Yeah. And so that's one small answer. There's a lot of other answers that relate to power and economic power and those kinds of things, and that's a different set of issues. But the small answer is to change the way we all eat.
Okay, last question, Naomi, and then I'm gonna transit back to
someone. What was the date of the Golden Rice follow-up?
I'm only going from what I haven't looked it up, but it was in the last decade that they switched over.
So it was interesting. When I was in the Bali study, work on the rice book, it was in the spring of 1992. And in that era, there was new crop rice because the Balinese were being pushed to increase their production. So they had their traditional rice, which grows to be nearly 4 feet tall and as far as to nearly tall. And then they had the new style rices from, you know, Philippines, wherever, which they could do 3 or 4 crops a year, because there isn't really a seasonal thing in Bali, it's all irrigation. And what was happening, what we saw in the course of 10 weeks there, was a rice crop that was planted just near where we were staying, and that failed. And it was a new crop. And at some point, they'd run out of the right micronutrients, because they
rely
on inputs to supply them. But the other thing that was happening was that the Balinese, it was a much higher price for the old crop rice, because it tasted better. And so in fact, the market was already pushing the Balinese to keep the old crop rice. So I'm surprised and saddened to hear about the golden rice introduction subsequent to my visit, right? Because they should already have known that was not going to work.
I think I've got to double check my dates. I can't claim to be an authority.
But anyway,
you can.
Interesting. It's very interesting. And the people were really clear, the values were really clear. If you can afford it, boy, you buy the traditional rice. Way better taste, way better behavior in lots of ways. Sorry, just to.
It's just
so
the main thing.
The
government.
Even in a place that's poor is in non industrialization, the market can push things back.
Yes.
Sorry to be like that, but seriously.
Well, this is a topic I think we could
stay for an hour, and that's why.
Well, I'm going to go sit next to Naomi and learn.
Thank you very much.